So of all the ways we've covered today that you could potentially break your tractor, if you pay attention to any of them and learn anything, it's this one right here. Hey, welcome back everybody. You know, a year and a half ago we did a video, 10 ways you can break your tractor. We're back with 10 more ways to break your tractor, or your skid steer, or maybe your gator, inspired by my own misadventures. And speaking of breaking your tractor, we did a video recently about wheel spacers and putting additional stress on your axle. I favor operator safety over machine safety. It seems most other folks do as well. I didn't have a single example come up in the comments section about anybody breaking their axle with wheel spacers. So if you need to add stability to your tractor, I'd encourage you to check out Bora. We are sponsored by them, but they make a very good wheel spacer made in America. There's a link down below. Hey, and we don't know if you enjoyed the video unless you give us a thumbs up. So be sure to do so and leave a comment down below. Join the conversation. You want to see more videos? Hit that subscribe button. And if you want something for your tractor, maybe something for the loader, something for the three-point, we can help and we ship all over the country. Check out goodworkstractors.com. I think the saying goes, more equipment, more problems. Or at least, that's what it should be, because got the skid steer going on, the gator, the tractor, my other tractor that's still in the shop, and it just seems like no matter what piece of equipment I have, there's a problem. So to maybe vent a little frustration, to maybe feel like I'm not alone, and maybe to help you prevent some of these problems from happening to you, I want to give you 10 more ways to break your tractor. Now, when I say tractors, I actually mean equipment in this video, because we're going to bring in the skid steer and the gator and tell you all the ways things have gone wrong. Okay, so first one happened on my skid steer. I think there's a chance that it could happen with the right piece of equipment on a tractor too. I had my mulcher head hooked up to this and let it sit out here for a few days after I was done using it, and came back and hopped in the skid steer and turned it on just fine. Went to raise the loader up and nothing happened. I mean, it was just like, just wasn't moving. Checking different things, check some fluid levels, realize the hydraulic oil is way low, like way low. I'm like, what the heck happened? I'm looking underneath all around the skid steer. There's no pools of oil anywhere. I mean, everything is bone dry underneath there. So long story short, I disconnect the mulcher head right there, go get a bunch of hydraulic oil, fill it back up on the skid steer. Loader's working just fine at that point. Then I get to work on the mulcher head, break open the side case, and I see there's just a bunch of oil in there. I blew a seal on the hydraulic motor, and since it was hooked up to my skid steer, it just drained. And maybe it's just because it was gravity and whatever else, but it just drained fluid. I don't even know how many gallons of fluid right out of that hydraulic motor, right underneath and into the ground. I guess I learned something new that day. It was a new way to drain the hydraulic oil out of your piece of equipment. Probably wouldn't happen very often. You know, you gotta have a hydraulic motor in that case and leave it connected. But that was the last thing I had expected to happen, and it turns out my day was done with that mulcher head before it even got started. Well, as of yet, this hasn't done anything more than provide cosmetic damage. And fortunately, I haven't done it myself, but I have bared witness to it actually happening, as well as having to repair the damage that was incurred by others. I'm talking about repairing the damage when you are reinstalling a front-end loader or maybe a backhoe. I can think of three specific examples. A long time ago, a guy wanted me to buy his 1025 from him, and it was pretty clear that he didn't have a lot of experience putting that loader back on. Unfortunately, I trusted his abilities to get his loader reinstalled on his tractor and sat there and watched him put some big old gouges in the side of these panels. I had a Kubota B-Series come in last fall that had some significant damage. You could tell it was from the loader getting reinstalled because there were just scrapes and everything up and down both sides of the hood cowling. They damaged the front surround, the lights. It was just a lot of, I don't want to sell equipment that looks like junk, so I had everything fixed up to look the way that it should, but even some bracketry for the parking stand was bent up. And we even have a BX23S right now that on both fenders you can see damage is kind of bent out and all wonky, all from the backhoe trying to be reconnected or maybe taken off. So you really want to take your time. These processes, the quick attach on Kubota, on John Deere, they all work very well, but when you are new to the process, it's not going to do you any good to rush through it. So I've made some videos for the John Deere's. There's some other good videos out there for the Kubota and probably others for similar brands as well, but check those out. Take your time. The last thing you want to do is live with some goofy cosmetic damage just because you were kind of rushing through it those first few times. As hot as it is, I want to think about being cold right now. That would feel good. Although when this next one occurred, I did not appreciate it being cold. So some of you probably saw we had the gator down by the lake, and it was middle of winter trying to help out a friend get unstuck, which we did successfully, and then we managed to get stuck way worse ourselves in the gator. It was a whole debacle. There was no way around that, and ended up freezing down in the mud. The tires, everything was frozen solid. It didn't help because we ended up breaking our front axle and tearing up the CV joints and just all around just making a mess. It was way worse than it had to be. I don't know what we could have done differently. In hindsight, just don't bring the gator down there. It was just one of those things, you know, we had a winch, we had snatch blocks, nothing made a difference. It was bad. It was swampy right on the shore in the wintertime. And anyway, that was 3 days I don't want to go through ever again. So that poor gator, this poor gator had no chance of going back up the hill that we went down to begin with. We wanted to make it around the shoreline, around a flatter piece of ground. We walked it, had no problems, but as soon as we drove on it, we sunk down. There were some things I think that we just wouldn't have known doing it over again, but I can tell you this, the gator's still for sale all these months later. Any takers? So as far as lessons learned go with this one, I can think of several. Don't take your gator down a hill and think it's gonna go right back up. Don't use your gator in the wintertime or really off of paved surfaces. I mean, if you're gonna do that, make sure it's nice and dry in the summertime and pretty flat like what you have out here. And it's really just a show pony. Okay, let's flip the script going from the dead of winter to the dead of summer. We had some major problems with a couple pieces of equipment recently. The first one, mowing with the 4720 and the Batwing mower. Some serious overheating going on. So the needle was slowly creeping up, but it was in the green. I turned it off to take a break, clean off the grill. There wasn't much on the grill. Anyway, a couple minutes later, I turned it back on. All the signals are blaring at me, basically. It's overheated. Red stoplight, high temp on the dash, needle's buried in the red. That's a problem. Well, it turns out that tractor actually had some issues with the water pump, maybe the thermostat, and just the whole coolant system that we're still dealing with. Some comments down below in that video, though, helped save the day the next time it happened on the 1025R. We've been doing a lot of tilling for the driveway prep. It was really hot out again, taxing the system with that PTO going the whole time. I saw that needle creeping up, but we were almost done. Didn't quite make it. So that tractor had a protective system in place when that needle reached the red, when I just wasn't watching it. It killed the rear PTO. I dropped it down to idle instead of turning it off. That allowed the system to keep cycling fluid and dissipate the heat. And I pulled out my phone and watched it kind of recover. In about a minute and a half, minute 45 seconds, that needle went from in the red down to the green and recovered. We were able to finish up and get on our way. So it may seem counterintuitive, but turning off your tractor in that kind of situation is bad. Leaving it on at a low idle is going to allow that fluid to still circulate. And instead of, if it's off, it's just a heat sink and it's just sitting there kind of just building up heat. If you leave it on and let that engine and the coolant system just cycle and do its thing, it's going to burn that heat off and let you get back to work. So this next one, we inherited this problem. We didn't cause it, fortunately, but we did have to pay the price to fix it. On this BX23S that we had, we wanted to put some front wheel spacers on it. The front right hub was a bit mangled. So there was one lug that was missing, could not go back in because it was just too gummed up, the threads were. We broke off, you know, my mistake, I guess. I don't know what I could have done. Some guy said maybe heat it up with a torch before trying to get that lug bolt out. But we broke it off, sheared it off right in there. So we had to take it into the Kubota dealer, see if they could work their magic to get everything re-threaded, get that sheared off one out. They couldn't. We had to get a whole new hub for that front right side. Actually came out a lot cheaper than I thought, but I'm telling you, that was just a pain to deal with. And one thing I learned, a great tip in there, and something I typically don't do, but I was guilty of it in this video, is using an impact driver or a drill of some kind to start your threads. You don't want to do that. You want to start them by hand, let them get seated and set, and then you can finish them off with your impact or your drill. But you don't want to get those things stripped or cattywampus in there, because you're going to cause a big headache down the road. It could mean you can't put your tire back on your tractor, and then what are you gonna do? But that was the type of project, installing wheel spacers all around, that if things are going right and smooth, you can do it in an hour, maybe an hour and a half. It took us 3 weeks to get that tractor back after we dropped it off at Kubota. Hey, we're gonna include one that actually I have nothing to do with, but I own the piece of equipment. I watched the videos of it happening to somebody else. Oh, PTO issues, aren't they fun to deal with? So, couple things going on with these. We're standing by a Rhino TS10. This is my TS10. Tractor Time with Tim had a major snafu with his, and something to do with the instructions. You want to read those, you know, but we've all done it. I'm guilty of the same exact thing myself, but I think he didn't have a minimum clearance between the gearbox on the cutter and the gearbox on his 2038. It's one of those things you don't give a lot of thought to until it's too late. He was loading everything onto his trailer, and so the mower is relatively flat like this. Ramps going up on the trailer, and so when everything's flat, no problem. But as you start to pitch up, you're shortening that angle. So the PTO shaft is above that pivot point, and so that amount of length on the shaft is shortening. Do you see where I'm going with this? Well, at some point, your shaft cannot get any shorter. And so something had to give, and that was gonna be the guts, the backside of his tractor, which he didn't even realize right away. He went ahead and started mowing for a while on a project and everything was just fine. And then all of a sudden it wasn't. Now we had our own close call earlier. The guys, everybody makes a mistake, right? But they were putting on the tiller on my tractor for me. I just didn't have enough time. And the PTO shaft, boy, it was close. So you wanna make sure when you're cutting a PTO shaft that you cut an equal amount from both ends of it. It's a two-piece shaft. You have one piece here, one piece there. So you cut off the same amount from both ends. And you wanna do that at the shortest point, which is gonna be perfectly level. So when the gearbox on the attachment is level with the gearbox and the rear PTO on your tractor. Well, for whatever reason, that just didn't work out, and we got it out here and found out the hard way when we tried to take it off that it was jammed just too far. The front end, the connection side on the PTO shaft was jammed just too far where we could not get it off of the PTO splines without the use of a pry bar back at the shop. Alrighty, so next one, your buckets. A lot of you John Deere owners in particular, myself included, we get a lot of tractors in that have, in particular, a bent top rail. So in my opinion, this is all about having a little bit too thin of steel on the standard duty bucket for the John Deere loaders. You know, this top rail gets destroyed, gets mangled, easy to bend, it's thin steel. You can get a heavy duty bucket that is way better. But this version here, you can see why I have these bucket brackets on here. You can get those from JU Fabworks. You order right from their website and you save 5% with code GWT. But that's gonna help protect and reinforce the top edge of those John Deere buckets. And it's also gonna give you more versatility. I think it's a cheapskate move by John Deere. Kubota doesn't really have much of that issue. If you haven't ordered your tractor yet, then maybe you consider getting one of those heavy duty John Deere buckets. Or if your bucket's too far gone, we do sell HLA buckets as well. Even though they're standard duty, they're quite similar to the John Deere heavy duty bucket, and we can ship all over the country. Well, this one's a pretty big deal for everybody and something that you do not want to make the mistake of having happen, and that is tipping over your tractor. I've covered it a whole lot, but ballast weight is very important. You need something on the back side of your tractor if you're going to use your front end loader. The tractor itself is just not heavy enough these days in order to properly offset that weight when you have a big old scoop full of dirt. I've done videos all about the topic, but you do not want to tip over your tractor. Not only are you going to break your tractor, you're going to break yourself. And I know it's frustrating to think about spending money when you can't really do any work with that money that you're spending, but it's gonna make you do work more safely and more efficiently. Get a ballast box, maybe put liquid ballast like I have inside the tires. We came out with this weight bracket. They're actually the first batch of 100 are coming very soon. Gonna have a weight bracket and suitcase weights, a whole bundle that we can ship right to your house. It's just simply too important. If you can afford a tractor, then you can afford the ballast weight to be set up safely. And so that's gonna help you front to back, really evening out that weight proportion. Now these tractors are pretty long and narrow too, so we've installed wheel spacers on here. You may want to look into that to widen your footprint. The smaller subcompacts, you can actually get a dual wheel setup that's going to make it a lot more stable. Or at the very least, most of these wheels are going to be reversible. They're going to have an offset center plate, so it's not right in the middle. If you slash this, the width of the tire, the width of the wheel, it's not going to be perfectly in the middle. It's going to be offset to one side or the other, so you can have a narrow and a wide position for your wheelbase. So by doing so, you can change the width of your tractor to be a little bit narrower if needed, or a decent amount wider. So of all the ways we've covered today that you could potentially break your tractor, if you pay attention to any of them and learn anything, it's this one right here. So while the 4720 was out here overheating a couple weeks ago, we noticed it also had just a gigantic thorn in the tire as well. I couldn't bring myself to pull it out. I didn't want, just in case it went all the way through, all that liquid ballast to come flying out. So I left it in there for now. Figure we'll deal with that if it hasn't already worked its way out after we get it back up and running. A couple months ago, we were in at Meekoff Tire, and Adam there was helping us out install some wheel spacers. And we were just talking tractor tires and problems and whatnot. And one of the most common problems that he has come up are gonna be especially front tire issues with thorns and sticks and other things, because They're not all that thick. What are they? I think they're 4-ply. And Adam mentioned, I don't remember if he had a quantity or not, but he said on a weekly basis, he has more than one that come in with the front tires needing repairs due to thorns and sticks and everything else. So I subscribed to the channel Hometown Acres. He does a really good job over there. He did a video a little while back on a plug kit. I would suggest you guys keep them with you at all times so that if you do get a flat tire, a low air pressure situation, you can get that plug, get it pumped back up, and get back to work. This last one is just one of those gremlins that you just want to avoid at all costs. And when I had a 330G right before the 333, it came from a snow removal outfit, okay? So they had a couple seasons on it. It only had about 200 hours. And when we got it, shortly after is when the problem started. And I hate electrical issues, and basically the machine just wouldn't turn on. It would just do nothing, or it would run for a little while and then turn off. And we had the tech out 3 or 4 different times, new battery, you know, fuse this, rewire this, whatever. It was all sorts of stuff. Ended up having to take it in. And mind you, it's very inconvenient to have a piece of equipment that's down over and over and over. So when it was all said and done, it was about $3,000 to get everything corrected. None of that was covered under the warranty. So while the machine did have manufacturer's warranty, it doesn't cover corrosion. And so I'd urge you, if you have to use your equipment in a corrosive environment, you know, if you have to use it in salt in the wintertime, if you can't get in there midwinter to clean it all out, make sure it's the first thing you do when spring comes around. Otherwise, once these corrosion problems start, it's almost impossible to get rid of them. Well, that's gonna wrap up 10 more ways to break your tractor. This is the second edition. I really hope there's not a third. I wanna thank you so much for stopping by. If you did enjoy the video, we'd love to get a thumbs up from you and leave a comment down below. Subscribe to see more, and if you're looking for something for your tractor, check out goodworkstractors.com. So thanks for watching, and until next time, stay safe. We'll see you soon.